Please pray with me. Lord, we pray for peace in our world, peace in our home, peace in our country, peace in our neighborhood, peace within ourselves. Lord, you are the Prince of Peace and can bestow peace on us. We ask for this. We pray for our servicemen and women, particularly those who are in dangerous places. We lift to you today Jack and Chris, Brian and Matthew and Ryan. We pray for them and we pray for their loved ones and ask that you bring them safely home. We ask all these things, trusting in your power, O Lord, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Join me in the opening prayer. Almighty God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, speak to us in the language of our hearts, that we may hear your word with understanding and answer your call with confidence. Amen.
We're going to sing now our opening hymn, number 2243, We All Are One in Mission. I don't see any munchkins here, so we will move on to the pastoral prayer. Let us pray together. Lord, we have lifted to you our joys and concerns, and we lift them with thanks, for we know that you hear the prayers of your people. We thank you for your care for us, your care for creation. You put humans in the garden to work and till it, and Some are faithful to that, but so many are wasteful. Admonish us to do a better job taking care of your world and all that live within it. The forests, the lakes and streams, the ocean, your creatures that you have made, and your people. Give us fresh eyes so that when we look at one another, we search for the face of Christ. Show us how to acknowledge one another, even when we keep our social distance. Lord, strengthen our sense of human kindness and help us to remember that each one struggles in their own way. And now, O Lord, we bring to you those things that we do not share easily out loud. Unafraid and unashamed, we come before you, asking you to draw close to hear the prayers of your people. For these prayers and the prayers of all of those who call upon your name, we give you our thanks. For we trust in our relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ, who invites us to live as a community of faith and asks us to pray as one. So in symbol of both, we say these beloved words together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine are the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. We may be small in numbers, but I believe that we are mighty in spirit. And Chantel, my daughter, and I, we're going to sing Lamb of God. And of course, my mother is over here as well. So we have this three-generational music problem happening.
Sin too high, but you have said.
scripture lesson is 1 Corinthians 12:12 through 27. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all of the members of the body, through many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For by one Spirit we're all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would we be hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the organs in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single organ, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body which seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those parts of the body which we think less honorable, we invest with a greater honor, and our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty. Which of our presentable parts do not require? But God has so composed the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior part, that there may be no discord in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. I think that's it.
Pray with me that the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts together, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our salvation. Amen. So today we look at the church, because every creed says something about the nature and purpose of the church. You may have read in a bio that was done that I have a dual degree in elementary education and dramatic arts. And why I loved dramatic arts so much was not because I wanted to be up in front of people and be a famous star, that actually I'm much more comfortable pulling the curtain. But what I love about the theater is that you'd have these groups of individuals who have nothing in common in terms of their gifts and graces and their talents. You have a carpenter, and you have a painter, and you have an electrician, and you have someone that's good with fabric, and someone good with makeup or with hairstyling, and you have detail people, and then you have your, you know, divas, and you've got somebody trying to coordinate. And all of these different folks are working towards a common purpose, which is the production. And I always, that intrigued me. In fact, there was a time when I desired to be the artistic director of a residential theater, a community theater, because I liked that. I liked that idea that we could take all these varied personalities and skill sets and move beyond our differences towards a common purpose. Well, that dream of mine went away because I was called into pastoral ministry. And then about 10 years into it, it occurred to me, well, I'm doing exactly what I wanted to do in the theater, working with a group of varied people all towards a common purpose. The purpose is not the production. The purpose is to be at work in God's kingdom. That's the purpose, to share the love of Christ with each other, to equip the world with God's Spirit, to move towards peace and wholeness. And I thought to myself, well, how funny is that, that I kind of went full circle. The Apostle Paul tells us that we are all members of the same body and that Christ is the head of the church, and we are all part of that body. Christ is the brain. Good. Let Christ have that job. And then the rest of us are different parts. We might be the eye, we might be the ear, we might be the nose, we might be the hand, we might be the arm, we might be the foot. And all parts are necessary. And one of the things that I have learned in the life of the church is that we are only as strong as our weakest member. And that one of the things that is so important in the church is that we move together. There are many biblical models for leadership that we can find through scripture. There's the parent figure, there's the prophet figure, there's the warrior, there's the evangelist, there's lots of figures. One of the assignments that was given to me once was to identify what is my biblical form of leadership, and I realized that mine is shepherd. That's mine. I keep track of the sheep, make sure we're all together and we're moving as one. There was an event that happened in Waterloo where we were trying to, we decided that since the last time the sanctuary had been painted was 1963, that it was time to paint it again. And the last time the carpet had been installed was 1963, and it was time to do the carpet again. It really needed it. It just needed it. There were cracks that needed to be fixed, and we just needed it. Well, someone had the idea, well, if we have to take the pews out in order to paint, why don't we get chairs? So there was a movement to try to present arguments why chairs would be better than pews, because we could redesign the worship area. When you have pews, you're limited in what you can do in your worship space. That those with arms would be easier for people to get out of, so for some of our older members. And anyway, it went on and on and on, and there were some that were for it, and there were some that were against it, and there were some that were threatening to leave if we switched it, and you know, it went on and on and on. And every Sunday, I would get a person's vote verbally while we shook hands. Good morning, nice sermon, don't move the pews. You know, that's kind of how it went. So after, oh my gosh, probably 6 or 7 months of hearing this conversation, I said, let's take this particular month and we will vote. So somewhere you can vote, you can mail in your ballot, or you can vote. You must sign your name because we're gonna check for duplications and you need to vote. And there was one provision that I made, because honestly, I sit in a chair, so it didn't really matter to me. And that provision was that it be a 2/3 majority. If it was not a 2/3 majority, then we stay where we are. We don't go forward. And I remember the people who were advocates of this were agitated by that request, and they said, well, why is that? And I said, because if it's a simple majority, it could split the church. If it's a 2/3 majority, we know that's what the majority wants. And people understand that about voting, so it must be a 2/3. Well, one person who was a little snappy said, why do you get to say that? And that's when I drew upon another biblical image. I said, because I'm the mom. And they were like, okay. Well, as it turned out, it was a 2/3 majority, more than 2/3 majority, and we moved and did chairs, and no one left the church, and it's fine. Then we had to vote on a carpet, and we had carpet samples brought in, and we had things brought in. Now on that, I had a particular desire for a certain color of carpet. So I want you to know that the four Gospels voted, the 12 disciples voted, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit voted. I did my best. They were all taken out, of course, because they knew it was unlikely that they had voted. Still got my carpet color, though. That's my legacy. It's all I got. But one of the things that I know in terms of the church, the purpose of the church, is that we are called to participate. Now, you might think that you don't have much to offer. I'm just a person. I show up. I give my $2 a week. It's all I've got. I don't have anything to contribute. I can't do public speaking. I no longer can lift a hammer. I'm limited in what I can do. So there's no place for me to be active in the life of the church. One of the things that I think we can squeeze out of this scripture passage is that God will use all of you. See, sometimes when we apply for a job, we're supposed to tell them either in our resume or in our conversation why it's in their best interest to hire us, that we let them know what our strengths are, what our skills are, what is compelling so that they might say, yes, I want you to be a part of the team. And sometimes we think that we have to do the same thing in the life of the church. I would say no. God can use all of you, including your vulnerabilities, including your weakness, including the part of you that is fragile. God can use that in the church. Remember the song that used to be done back when there were roller skating rinks? Every time we went roller skating, they did the hokey pokey. Do you remember that? The very idea. I could do my hands, but getting my leg in there was always a bit of a test. You do the hokey pokey and you turn yourself around, that's what it's all about. You know the song. But eventually, after you've done your limbs and your head, you have to put your whole self in and do the hokey pokey and turn yourself around. Eventually, it asks all of us, all from us. And that's what the purpose of the church is to squeeze each of us until all that we have is used for God's glory. I have my vulnerabilities. I have my places that are fragile. You might not believe this because I'm not shy, but I'm actually an introvert. My husband was an extrovert. We'd go to a party, like let's say a graduation party, and soon as we were done with the first party, I was ready to go home. He was ready to go to the next party. He got energy from other people. I feel energy drained. If I have a time where I'm in this big thing because I have to be function, I usually need a bit of a nap afterwards because I have to recharge my batteries. I wish I were otherwise, but God is using that part of me because I can spot the other introverts at a party. And I can seek them out. And in a quiet way, have a one-on-one conversation with them where we keep the rest of the crowd at bay so that we can just visit. And before long, they're comfortable because they haven't been asked to embrace the whole room, just to embrace the conversation with one person. That's where God has used my weakness. Sometimes I think what we need to do instead of identifying our strengths is to identify those places where we feel that we fall short and ask God, so what good can you do with this? That might be followed with a parenthetical, I dare you. And God will use it in ways that will surprise you. In ways that will cause you to shake your head till it rattles. In ways that will compel you to say, wow, thanks. I never knew you needed me. But in this moment, in this situation, for this purpose, I was exactly the right person for the task. Wow. Thank you for using me. The church exists for the purpose of spreading the good news about God's redemptive work through Jesus Christ. And each of us have a role to play in it. No one is exempt. I remember the first church I served, there was a woman who I'm sure is with the Lord now. Her name was Thelma Call. And Thelma was the finance secretary for this little church I had in Hemlock, New York, that had between 15 and 35 people on a Sunday. It was a small student appointment. And we were getting to the point of talking about assignments and officers for the next year, and Thelma had a tendency to be a little moody, and so she said to me, I remember two conversations with her, and the first one was this, where she said to me, I think we should get somebody younger to do the finance secretary. I'm getting on in years, and I think, and I said, are you having problems counting, or is accuracy gone, or is there something? No. I just think we should get somebody younger. And with all of the wisdom that comes when you are in your first appointment, I said with tremendous diplomacy, are you dead yet? No? Then I think you can do the job. I'm leaving you on. Oh, okay. I do. It has nothing to do with this sermon, but I have to tell you the other Thelma Call experience. She was in Thompson Memorial Hospital in Canandaigua, New York, and I went to visit her. And she was in a semi-private room, and she said, wow, this is a banner day. My roommate's pastor came to visit. And I said, well, how did you know it was the pastor? Well, he came in, he kind of had a nervous laugh, and he listened, and then he offered a prayer, and then he left. And I said, well, Thelma, I don't have a nervous laugh. And she said, yeah, but no one would mistake you for a pastor. One of the saints of the church. My wish for each one here is that you call upon God to help you identify what gifts and what frailty you bring to the body of Christ. You're not asked to be the whole body. No one's asking you to be the foot and the arm and the ear and the eye and the nose and the mouth, just a part of the body. What is your part? Because every part is essential. Paul says so, and I believe his words were inspired. May you identify that. And when you have, both your strength and your weakness will come and have a conversation with me, and we will find your spot. It might be something you've done before. It might be something you've never, ever tried. And it might be the very thing we need to move us forward. To God be all the glory. Amen.
Amen, Laura, for those wonderful words. Great message. His eye is on the sparrow. We would like to share this song with you next.
Why should my heart long for heaven and home. When Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know
dedication. We offer to you, O God, a portion of our wealth, a larger portion of our hands, a full portion of our hearts. Please receive these gifts and bless them. Put all to good use for the work of your kingdom. Amen.
Move the faithful.
God, the author of life, in the name of Jesus Christ, who redeems our life, in the name of the Holy Spirit that sustains us in life, go forth from this place, renewed and at peace. Amen.